There are over 100 billion planets in the Milky Way. Even if only 1 in 1,000 were habitable, that would leave us with millions of worlds filled with alien life. With all these potentially habitable planets, it's worth asking, what would life look like on alien worlds? Be sure to check out part 1 after this. Imagine a planet like Earth orbiting not one star, but two. This is Eden. The light from its twin stars powers photosynthesis, pumping oxygen into the atmosphere. Here on Earth, only 21% of our atmosphere is oxygen, but 300 million years ago, it was as high as 35%. This gave rise to dragonflies 2 feet in length, and giant millipedes that could grow 5 feet long. But this period in Earth's history only lasted 64 million years, the blink of an eye on evolutionary timescales. Here on Eden, fueled by the planet's two stars, the atmosphere is 40% oxygen, and it's been that way for nearly 2 billion years. How would life evolve on such an extremely oxygenated world? Like on Earth, grazers feed on low-lying fungus, but they're constantly alert to danger. The canopy is home to predators perfectly evolved to live among the trees, waiting for their moment to strike. On the ground, the grazer has the edge. It's faster in a chase. But the predator has evolved a special weapon, a hidden set of hands that can spring out from its body, one last chance to grab its prey. This time, the grazer escapes, and the predator conserves its energy. Summer is breeding season for the grazers, but always fearful of predators, they don't have time to find a mate. Instead, they produce worm-like spawn. Each needs to fuse with another to form an embryo. This isn't a brand new concept. Here on Earth, salmon do a similar external fertilization, with males and females releasing their sperm and eggs into the water to be externally fertilized. Back on Eden, for protection, these spawn form a cocoon. Suspended above the ground, the embryos can grow outside the reach of predators. The grazers have evolved to breed fast. They produce as many offspring as quickly as possible to ensure the survival of the species. But in the forest, they're never truly safe. As summer ends, the fungi grow orange-colored fruit that attract the grazers. Spores within the fruit spread an infection. Now, when the predators attack, infected grazers don't run. They've lost their fear instinct. The fungi have used the grazer to infect and kill the predators. We have a deadly three-way symbiotic relationship. Life in the Forest of Eden is a constant battle between the fungi, grazers, and predators. But there are also greater celestial forces at play. Eden has stronger seasons than on Earth. No matter what planet you're on, the rhythm of the seasons is dictated by the tilt of a planet towards its star. Earth is tilted at an angle of 23.5 degrees. On Eden, that angle is 40 degrees, so during the summer, more light spreads across the planet's northern hemisphere. But it's starting to get colder. As winter approaches, the remaining predators migrate, chasing the light, and the ones that don't make it die. It's the same every winter. Nothing grows in the dark forest, except the embryos in their cocoons. On Earth, some of the greatest migrations are fueled by seasonal changes like these. The tiny Arctic tern weighs just 113 grams, only a quarter of a pound, but it makes the longest migration in the world. Terns migrate following the summer light. Sunlight illuminates the ground and ocean surface, allowing the birds to see fish and insects more clearly. And to follow the summer light, the Arctic tern flies 30,000 kilometers, all the way from the south to the North Pole, seeing two summers. With it, they also see more daylight than any other animal on Earth. Back here on Earth, the planet continues to orbit around its stars, and just as spring arrives, the grazers hatch. More light means more life. It's spring, and there's food to eat, but the new grazers need to grow as fast as possible before the predators return. And there, the life cycle repeats, creatures thriving on sunlight and the energy it carries. What's true on Eden may be true throughout the universe, that all life depends on the flow of energy. This is how these circumstances could give rise to life on this imagined alien world. But what would life look like under other circumstances? Across the galaxy, we find a planet much older than Earth. Imagine a planet 9 billion years old, twice as old as Earth, old enough that a truly advanced civilization could have evolved. Like Earth, it was once a fertile world. Now it's barren. But life can still thrive here in artificial domes. Plants convert sunlight into sugars, which feed the inhabitants of Terra. Each box contains the brain matter of a super intelligent being. Over time, they've evolved to not need their bodies. They only exist as neural tissue. They never age, they never die. They're monitored and maintained by robots. Each is an individual, but they're connected to think as one, the hive mind of a hyper-advanced civilization. But the civilization on Terra is in peril. Its star is double the age of our own sun, and as stars get older, they burn bigger and brighter. Eventually, the planet will be incinerated, so an escape plan is underway to colonize another planet in the solar system, further from the star than Terra. There's ice on this world, but no atmosphere. It needs to be manufactured. This is engineering on a planetary scale. Giant machines melt the ice caps to create vapor and gas, generating enough atmosphere to warm the planet. Such a massive project requires a massive amount of energy, delivered directly from the aging star. The civilization on Terra built solar panels in space, near to its star, for maximum effect. But as the star becomes bigger, it also becomes more volatile. A solar flare can easily destroy the electronics. Sooner or later, this will be the destiny of Terra itself, to be swept away by the power of its sun. They need to colonize the planet as quickly as possible. There are no life forms on the new planet. All the work is done by machines. They're able to think for themselves and make their own decisions with an advanced form of artificial intelligence. If humans want to form colonies in space, the groundwork would probably be done in the same way with robots, just a bit stupider ones. Without input from any life form, the robots are re-engineering a planet, making it ready for colonization. Once finished, it's time to abandon Terra. Each of the domes have been designed for this exact moment to get into orbit. From there, they'll travel to their new home. The domes have their own life support systems, but they're helpless against a high energy burst of radiation. Long distance space travel has its risks, even for intelligent beings. A sudden solar flare can have disastrous effects, but for those that make it to the end of this journey, this is their reward, a new Terra. Rather than adapting to a different world, they've adapted the world to them. Don't ask me why they didn't do all this before becoming a head in a jar. This is just how these aliens roll. But these good times won't last forever. The star will keep growing bigger and brighter, spitting out more radiation, and in a few hundred million years, eventually, it will render even the new planet as lifeless as Terra. And then they'll need to relocate again, to another planet further from the star. This is the advantage of being mobile. It's possible to travel from world to world, making and remaking a home. Who knows, maybe there's an alien civilization already heading to Earth to remake it as they want. To that I say,
I guess we'll never know.
This is how life may have adapted to live on these two imagined worlds. But how would life evolve to live in a world twice as big, with twice as much gravity as Earth? Or on a planet so close to its star, it's tidally locked, so as it rotates, it only ever shows the same face to its sun. Watch part 1 to find out. And remember, there is always more to learn.